and you go through the rigorous training that we went through, it makes you, I'd like to say it makes you a man. I mean, you just learn things that sometimes we think are simple things, and yet they're very, very important things. Like discipline, how to handle discipline. Going through the cadet life, Ian, was a real experience.
Well, right at Pearl Harbor was a time in the history of this country which has been no other. Everybody wanted to jump in and serve. One of my brothers was in the Marine Corps already, and I decided that I wanted to be a part of the Marines. So I volunteered in 1942.
And I went through a boot camp and was a rifleman and all that stuff when I was 16, of all things. And I knew if I went in the Army, I'd be in the infantry, and I wasn't going to do it. So I joined the Navy. That's what caused it. It's how it came about, really.
When I first went in there, I was in an instrument survey battery, and I wasn't really interested in carrying all that surveying equipment around, and I wanted to be a chef someday. So I wrote the battalion commander a letter and told him how much better I could serve the country if I was in the food service. So it didn't take them long. They said, about somebody's crazy here. Let's making him a cook.
I was in the Coast Guard, but the Coast Guard in World War II was everywhere. We operated with the Navy. And that's the reason I've got my Navy cap on, because I spent 46 months in the Coast Guard, and when I got out, I joined the Naval Reserve. So I had the same rank in the Navy when I got out as I did in the Coast Guard, so I actually served in two services.
When I went to San Diego, they lined us up, and they came and said, "You're in the Navy. You're in the Marines, you're in the Navy, you're in the Marines." I just happened to hit the Navy.
Once we were in, Japan was dumping Japanese ammunition in the ocean. We'd bring it in by train to a railhead, and then we'd load it on ships and take it out and just dump it in the ocean. Getting rid of the ammunition mainly.
Well, I was in the Philippines. We were drawing maps. I was in a map-making outfit. We were drawing maps for the invasion of Japan. And, of course, you know what happened to the atom bomb.
We were supposed to go to the Pacific. And they kept holding us and holding us and holding us. There's 10,000 of them. And they come in and took our winter clothes, or our summer clothes away from us, and give us winter clothes. Said, "You're going to Germany. We need you over there worse." So we went to Germany, 10,000, on one ship. They had beds on the ship, bunks stacked up like that, six high.
Mostly in the Pacific, all the way from Hawaii into the Philippines. New Guinea, I was in New Guinea, and spent quite a bit of time in the Philippines.
We'd slaying wire there and buying fast. We'd slaying wire to each company. In the observation post, everything. And
I was on a tanker. We had 330,000 barrels of airplane fuel. We traveled alone because our ship was speedy enough to do that. We did not have any detection devices, and fortunately for us, nobody with a submarine was close at hand.
And I still have information on here on making exposures. That's it there. And you look through here, and I made a little wire viewfinder and had it on here. That is for quick shots, and it worked fine. It didn't show, I say, quite all of the picture, but it wasn't enough to matter usually.
The troops, the supplies started coming in about 10 days before June the 1st, and they'd fill up all the vacant spaces there, the fields and the roads, and our unit would transport the supplies and equipment out to the larger ships in the harbor at Plymouth, England.
We patrolled the North Atlantic. We were a coastal group, actually, and we swept from mines up and down the Atlantic coast from New Jersey up to Newfoundland and back. That's really what we did.
The first experience was when I was in basic training. We was flying BT-13s. It was a basic training plane, and the first time my most exciting experience was when we went to high altitude and my instructor put the plane in a tailspin and coming down in a tailspin and then kicking the rudder and so on to get come out level. That was one of the most exciting times as far as flying.
I was in the 104th Infantry Division when the war was over. We went to France and we was relievers, replacements, went over as replacements. So they just took some here and some there, anywhere they needed us. And I happened to be one of the last ones, so I got to see the stuff up there that I didn't want to see.
We attacked many submarines during a course of running convoy duty from the East Coast to North Africa and into Europe. The killer submarines are out there looking to sink ships, and we were escorting 150 merchant ships, 23 days to go over, 23 days to come back. And on every trip, one of the escort vessels around the convoy would pick up a contact of a submarine. And then we would attack with depth charges and what we call K-guns to try to ward them away. And we had no idea how many we might have hit because you didn't get credit for a submarine unless it surfaced. But yes, that was combat. It's in the naval term.
The lieutenant, my platoon lieutenant, said, "White cannot go. Hey, you got to stay here and get a haircut or shave. And I need a volunteer to take his place." This ended and said, "I'll take his place, Philip Adkins." And he got my Jeep and went on over to finish that line out that we started. And they put mortars in there and killed him. They brought him back dead.
I remember one time we had a ice cream freezer went down because the motor wasn't bad in it. And so an electric motor fell to the electricians to take care of. We didn't have anything to rewind the electric motor with, so they sent me to an aircraft carrier that had the equipment to rewind the motor. And I didn't rewind the motor, but I got to watch them rewind the motor. And when I come back, I reckon they thought I rewound it. So they put me up to second class electrician.
Here come a German aircraft with all of its guns, all four machine guns shooting. And I had the only light in the whole area in my hand, and he was shooting at me. So I grabbed my rifle, and you don't shoot right at a German plane if you expect to hit him, because he'd be gone before you could ever turn around. But what you do, you line up your, you see where he's coming, and you shoot up in his where he's coming to, and he's going to run into your bullets. So I filled the air full of bullets, and the next morning they came to where I was over at the tent in the camp, told me that a German aircraft had been shot down the night before. And I knew I was the only one shooting back that night. And I do know that I shot him down.
When we first went into combat, it lasted 94 days. I fought 94 days without stopping or any rest other than just fighting.
August the 7th, 8th, and 9th, we were continually bombed by the Japanese from above. And they were coming over with about 24 Japanese bombers. And I can remember there were five of us after we finished stringing our telephone wires to the first, fifth, and seventh Marines. We stood up there and we watched these 24, 25 silver bombers coming towards the airport. And we looked up there and our mouths went down. They were so beautiful looking. All of a sudden, we heard boom, 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 boom. And there was a 500-pound bomb that landed about 100 yards away from us.
Well, I landed in Normandy on Omaha Beach. And then I fought across France through the hedgerow country and into the Battle of the Bulls. I fought all the way across France.
Then about June the 1st, the troops started coming in, all the combat troops. They came in by the thousands, and we transported them out to the larger ships out into the outer harbor, and it continued. Then the D-Day was supposed to have been on June the 5th, but because of the bad weather, they had to postpone it, and that, of course, the troops were all on board the ship. They're ready to go, and they were very anxious to have something to happen. But on D-Day, by the afternoon, we were bringing back wounded people to take to the hospitals in England. And I have here, on D-Day, the casualties alone was 6,603 people. Now, that don't mean death. There were 1,465 dead, 3,184 wounded, 1,928 missing, and 26 unaccounted for. So you see, the first day of the invasion was strictly a very bad day.
And that was one thing we discussed, was would we be taken prisoner or would we rather die? And most of the time we'd decide that we'd not be taken prisoner. But I never did have that close to call of being taken a prison.
That meant that we had to back the ship down and retrieve our cable and try to get that thing off. Well, in putting it, the wind was blowing such a way we had a little problem keeping it straight into the big old, there was a big old reel about that much, about that big, in the back of the thing that held this cable. And it popped loose and it threw me over the side, you know. And I swam around in the ocean for 10 seconds till I got out. It's quite an experience. I had on foul weather gear and it was cold and the wind was blowing and I thought, well, I'm gone, but I wasn't. I bobbed right back up and they threw me a thing and pulled me in. It was exciting.
Memorable would be when the flag went up on Iwo Jima. I was quite close. My squad was probably a block and a half away if you want in terms of footage. It was on the fifth day of the invasion, and I was a gunner, and one of my ammunition carriers shouted at me, "Clayton, look towards Mount Suribachi." And I turned around and looked, and I could see among the shelling,
when there's a lot of shelling going on, my boy, there's just everything in the air. Through it all, I could see the red part of the flag.
And we had the bivouac there, and the snow was about 4 to 8 inches deep. And all we had was two blankets. We slept in the back of the truck all that time. And then because of the uncertainty of what the Germans were going to do, they were given quite a battle there. That was one of the worst battles in the war.
And here's a casualty here where a soldier was shot, even in the area where we were. Now we had guard duty there, and there weren't many Japs there.
Well, I would say December the 7th when the Japs hit us there. I'd been on security all night and just had laid down across my bunk, and Harry Albright, one of my motorcycle men, come running through, hollering, get up, the Japs are bombing us, the Japs are bombing us. So he didn't have to say it twice. And I went down and jumped on the motorcycle and went to the gate, and I was missing my buddy. I said, where's Lloyd at? And they said, we don't know. So I jumped on the motorcycle, started back up, and here come a Japanese plane strafing at me, and I just laid my motorcycle down and dove under a car, which I knew that was, later was the wrong thing to do, because if he'd hit that car in the gas tank, I'd have been gone. But I found Lloyd standing up there in the middle of the ball field hollering, cussing the Japs, and had a BAR in his hand. I said, get on this motorcycle, boy. I took him back to the gate. I saved his life that morning. That earned me the Bronze Star.
This happens to be the European theater that I qualified for, European African theater. This is the American theater medal. This is the Pacific theater medal. This is good conduct. This is extenuated sea service. And of course, this is what we call the ruptured duck. And this is my dog tag, which everybody had. And then, of course, I had the two insignias on with the fouled anchors, because I did the Coast Guard is one with the shield. And that's the tattoo I have on my arm. And then the U.S. Navy, of course, is the one that I happen to wear here, because I had the two caps, but the other didn't have a white cap cover. So this is there are no combat stars on there. We never got credit for sinking a submarine. If we would have, or bringing one in, these would have had some stars on. And this is a World War II victory medal that everybody gets.
Yeah, I got two bronze stars, and I got a Purple Heart, and got five campaign stars, and I got a combat infantryman's badge.
The Japanese took the Philippines. You know, we went back in and took them back, and I was in on that, and they gave me a medal for Philippine liberation.
And then one night, me and a fellow soldier in the Battle of the Bulls was about to freeze to death. You couldn't dig in the ground, hit us so hard. So we've seen this opening under a building. It's too dark to see in there. We decided we'd crawl in there and get to sleep some, be warmer in there. And we unrolled our sleeping bags, and that other soldier said, it's awful lumpy on my back in here. And I said, I guess it's those sugar beets. They grow a lot of them up in this country. And we were so tired, we just went to sleep. Got up the next morning, we'd slept all night on hand grenades.
And I did. I slept with my bomb, with my head laying on a bomb. Those bombs were that big around. And I've slept several times with out on deck with my head laying on one of those bombs. And I told them, I said, well, if the bomb went off, I'd never know anything about it anyway. So it didn't worry me any at all.
Every time I look back, somebody was always looking after me. Because whenever I sat down or laid down, there was always somebody right next to me. They got it instead of me.
But it's a four-leaf clover she sent me, and I that might have brought me through December the 7th and Midway both. I don't know, but I still got it.
Oh, my good luck. I guess God took care of me. That's the way I feel about it.
One day for inspection, he was smoking cigars, or what it wasn't smoking, just had it in his mouth. Had been smoking and chewing on it. So he got by and he still had it. And I told him, I said, Vic, they're downstairs inspecting now. The colonel's down there and he's going to be up here in a minute. I said, you better do something with that cigar. He said, oh, don't worry about it. I'll take care of it. So he didn't have the cigar when it came for inspection. I didn't know what happened to it. But then when they started putting their clothes away, I found that cigar butt in my shoe.
The first day I was in service, I spent 24 hours on KP. So they broke me in right.
Our company, which is in charge of food, and we were running short of food. So I asked some of the men to take some dynamite out there in the bay and dynamite some fish. And the only problem with that, they went right next to the colonel's house to do it. But it turned out fine. He says, why did you do that? And I said, we're not getting the food. So he said, well, just get your Jeep and we'll go and we'll find out about that. So we went to Yokohama where they were dispensing it. And he said, he really worked them over, and from then on we had plenty of food.
We was dug in an apple orchard, and the next morning, on Christmas morning, we got up and it was cold, snow on the ground, and but we did manage to break ice and shave. It was a hard shave, but we cleaned up a little. But we didn't have nothing for Christmas. But I had one man in my squad. His mother had sent him a little box of candy and his little hard candy. And he had 12 little square pieces in it. And of course, we had 13 men in the squad. So he divided. He gave every man a piece of the candy, and that's our Christmas day. That's what we got for Christmas that day.
What do you remember most about the day you returned home?
Well, I guess being able to see my sweetheart.
The day the Japanese surrendered, I think at that time they had transferred me back to Hawaii, and I was sitting in a theater. And when the news came out, the theater shut down, and everybody took off to town or back to their barracks to celebrate.
Well, I guess we could say we was all brothers. Because we was all there for the same thing and looking forward to the same thing, for the war to be over, where we could all go back home. And you never met a stranger if he is American. It wouldn't know. He was like, in other words, he's your best friend, regardless whether you had ever saw him before or not.
So, Where's it going to stop? I don't know, but war is not glorious. I don't know if I can get away with this or not, but I'll use General Sherman's statement, war is hell. It's disruptive of everything, plus the destruction, the cost, but sometimes that's the only answer, I guess.